Hi, my name's Abbie MacKinnon, and I am the curator for space technology. Here at the Science Museum, we are thrilled when we're offered new science and technology objects. In fact, a box of objects has just landed on my desk today. Let's go check it out. Okay, I'm here joined by Jim Clemmet, who is the one who's dropped off this box of bits for me. Jim, can you just tell me a little bit about this box and what's inside?
Yes, of course. What we have here in front of us are samples from the Beagle 2 Mars lander. I was fortunate to be appointed as chief engineer for the mission. I'll be able to take you through some of the key stages of the operation of the mission, and also some of the parts that are part of the hardware of the lander.
And when did it launch, and what was it trying to achieve?
Everybody is familiar with the question: is there or was there life on Mars? You may recall that there was a meteorite that was found, and NASA looked at that meteorite, and they saw a feature in it which could have suggested life. It's a little bit like a grub. Turned out not to be, of course. but it did spark a lot of interest. And the idea was to try to see if we could answer that question with the Beagle 2 lander, which was led scientifically from the Open University by Professor Colin Pillinger. Colin was a huge motivator for the team, and also was the public face, and people are perhaps very familiar with that. But he basically persuaded the European Space Agency to support a mission of a lander to Mars on the Mars Express spacecraft, which is an orbiter launched together in 2003.
You mentioned about Beagle 2 looking for signs of life on Mars, whether, you know, current or past. What kind of equipment, generally speaking, was on board Beagle 2 to be able to investigate that?
There was a suite of instruments, scientific instruments, on the Beagle 2 lander. Some are a bit more mundane than others. For example, a stereo camera, a microscope, a device to gather samples on the surface. But the key science in terms of life was an instrument called the GAP, which is Gas Analysis Package, which was a miniature laboratory of its own. It had small vessels in there, which would then be heated, generating gas from the sample. The equipment that was inside filled a whole laboratory in the Open University. So that's the scaling down that had to be done for some of the science instruments on board.
That is incredibly impressive. And I've actually just spotted an object inside the box, which I think speaks a little bit to your talking about looking for life on Mars, and how the spacecraft, I think, needs to go through some really pretty rigorous cleaning process. Yes. So if we could talk a little bit about this.
So this is just a standard QWERTY keyboard, which we've used just to demonstrate to members of the team some of the processes that we have to do for missions that are going to land on other planets in our solar system. Particularly, there's a United Nations regulation which essentially says do not contaminate the planet with Earth debris. So to do that, surfaces would be cleaned, perhaps typically in an ultrasonic bath. Then you also have to go through a very high temperature for a prolonged period of time. From memory, temperature was 112 degrees, and you then try to sustain that for 48 hours.
And of course, you don't want any biological material accidentally traveling to Mars on Beagle 2, because that would have completely compromised all of the experiments.
That's right, yeah. That's right. So basically everything that we'll be showing you shortly would have gone through the process that I've just been describing.
The keyboard obviously didn't survive the oven.
No, and the idea of this was not to was not to prove the process, but to be able to pick this up and show this to members of the team so that they understood the severity of what we were putting every piece of kit through.
All right, Jim, let's take a look and see what else we've got in here. So, can you tell me a bit about this?
So this is just a sample of the structure of the aeroshell. Let me explain the aeroshell first of all. The Beagle 2 lander is essentially a sort of disc type of shape. It's like if you had two saucers and you put them together. But that lander is sitting inside an aeroshell to protect it as it comes through the Martian surface. These are structural ribs. They're inside the cone. And there's three of these. And this basically gives you an idea of the size of the back cover of the aeroshell. Structurally, that sees a lot of loads. It sees loads during launch, of course. Hitting the atmosphere of Mars generates a load, obviously, on the front heat shield. You've got thermal conditions. It starts heating up, as I say, as you start going through the atmosphere. But you've also got what we call the cruise phase, from point from launch to separation from Mars Express. So the piece of structure needs to be very solid. We have two parachutes on Beagle 2. For the initial entry, there's a pilot chute, and that gives you initial deceleration as you go through the top part of the atmosphere. So that is stowed in a package in this vicinity here. If you imagine this to be three, yep, it's in this vicinity, yeah, here. That parachute then pulls this away from the lander. This lander is now free-falling, but you don't want that to last for too long. So you have a larger parachute. That first one is only, from memory, about a meter in diameter. But what we have here is basically a dummy of the main parachute in its stowage state. And this parachute, when once opened up, is about 15 meters in diameter.
Wow.
So it's pretty large. The question is was it easy to fit the parachute into the aeroshell? Mm. The answer is no. The lander itself is, I think it was about 900 millimeter diameter. So it's not much bigger than what we're really looking at, yeah, here. So packaging that in there when you haven't got much depth as well and you've got all the instruments, it was crammed.
Let me grab the next two things. So please, can you tell me about these?
So the lander is now, hopefully, sitting on the surface of Mars. So now we have to open it up. So there's just one hinge does that. But the lander's bowl and the lid are actually still connected together. And there's what we call a clamp band goes around that that periphery, which is what, and this is three segments of a clamp band, like so. Mm-hmm. That's great. Okay, but how do we get rid of the clamp band? So that has devices in there, basically what's called a frangy bolt. And there's three frangy bolts in this, which again may not be too visible. This is just the bolt, but there's an actuator that goes with this as well, which is actually memory metal, and it expands and basically pulls the bolt apart, mm-hmm, which then allows the clamp band to spring open, mm-hmm, and move away from the lander. So now the lander is free, but there's still one hold down in the middle of the lander, mm-hmm, which I think we have in the box.
Oh, let's have a look.
This is essentially a column that's inside the lander base. So all the other equipment is sitting around here. The lander lid comes down onto this surface. This is mounted in the base, and this rod goes through here somewhere. And the pyrotechnic device, which is running, is here, is then fired, and that then cuts that rod. And the lid is now free to be lifted up by the hinge and open up the lander. You may have noticed that that is a single point failure. Single point failure basically is a high risk situation. Mm-hmm. If it could be redundant, then your risk drops a lot. With the mass constraint and the volume constraint we had, we had next to no redundancy in Beagle 2.
So everything had to work.
Everything has to work. It's a matter of being careful in design, choosing the right items, right products, and being careful about what you do choose. Mm. From a mass point of view, with mass being such a tight budget, at the very beginning, I asked everybody to give a breakdown of their piece of kit down to a level of 10 grams.
I think we've got one more object in this box.
Oh, okay.
The heaviest one.
Right. Yes. So now the lander base is sitting here. Now the lid has got four solar panels stowed in it. And this is a hinge. Nothing particularly exceptional about the hinge. It just has to be sized for lifting out one panel at a time. So there are four panels, so four of these hinges. And there's a bigger hinge, which is much bigger than that, to open up the lid from the base or the base from the lid. So these are key. Again, each one is individually a single point failure.
So Jim, Mars Express and Beagle 2 launched in June of 2003, and Beagle 2 set to touch down on Christmas Day of the same year. So can you tell me what happened?
On Christmas Day, I traveled up to Leicester University. There was a facility there at the National Space Centre, which was to be the control centre for the Beagle 2 mission. Mm-hmm. And so we sat in the room. They're waiting to hear that NASA's Odyssey orbiter was in position to receive a transmission from Beagle 2 on the surface. But there was no reaction on Beagle 2. There was no response. So we were there waiting and waiting and waiting, twiddling our thumbs, getting more depressed.
Yeah.
And trying to imagine what had happened.
So, Jim, can you tell us a little bit about when Beagle 2 was finally discovered?
So we had been looking at and requesting images from the high-rise camera on the NASA orbiter. And one individual was doing that, just that, and he identified a glint on the surface, which is unique. You don't get glints off the mm-hmm. surface of Mars. So he looked some more, and he notified the Beagle 2 team. Consensus was, yes, it is something unnaturally mm-hmm. glinting, which gave us an encouragement.
Yeah.
So we then got some more images and looked some more. And then eventually in one particular image, we could see at least three solar panels were shining. You could see them very clearly. Mm-hmm. It was middle of or so of 2015 that this discovery was identified.
Yes, more than 10 years later. Wow,
yeah.
It's a long
yeah.
wait. What kind of emotions did you have when you saw those photos for the first time?
I suppose it was, wow, can it really be? I suppose was the reaction.
Yeah.
I don't think I ever said that to myself, but I guess that's how I felt.
Yeah.
What we know from the images is that three solar panels are definitely deployed. Mm-hmm. Personally, I think four panels have deployed, at least partially. There is a bit of a shadow that suggests that it might be there.
Yeah.
But then that shadow might be a rock as well.
Yeah.
So you can't really tell. You can't come to a conclusion. Imagining this to be a solar panel, if that hinge hasn't lifted the panel up and the solar cells are this side as well. So if it's only partially gone up like that, we wouldn't necessarily see it in the images. And of course, if it is down here and not deployed at all, it's blocking the antenna here, so we'd not have any communication. It's easy to say one solar panel hasn't deployed. It's the easiest thing to say and explain it.
Right.
But equally well, it isn't necessarily that. It could be something broken on impact. Like, if one bit of electronics in there, a soldered joint, could be anything as simple as that. And until somebody goes there, we'll probably never know.
I can imagine that knowing that it had a soft landing and kind of did what it was supposed to do must have felt good.
Yes, I think since the discovery of Beagle on the surface, having landed where it should, having deployed bar maybe one solar panel. That's now regarded as a major success. Mm-hmm. If you look at NASA's pre-Apollo missions, the number of launches they did just to get to the moon in the first place, I forget, it goes into double figures, I think, before mm-hmm. they got real success there. So in our case, once. So can we go again, please, is the usual message. That is, I suppose, the ultimate reaction. Can we go again, please?
Thanks for watching this special unboxing video. If you want to see more content like this, like and subscribe. Now I better go deal with this box of bits.